We were going to have Pamela Geller and her security team come through there, a guest speaker from the Netherlands, and Geert Wilders, who's a politician there, who's on all kinds of, he has to live in safe houses because he's on so many terrorist lists. He was the guest speaker, and a caterer, one caterer. So my job was to not allow anybody into the facility through that entrance other than those three people, those two, the security teams and those folks. Seemed like a pretty easy job. I'm standing there, been there all day. It's a wide driveway, probably 30, 40 feet long. I had it all blocked off with these tall cones, about 4 feet tall, other than the width of enough for a car to get through on one end of it. And I kind of stood there by those cones and kind of near that opening most of the day. So I got there about 1:30, well, this attack occurred in 10 minutes to 7. So. And this is May in Texas. It wasn't blistering hot, but it was warm, so been a long day. So I'm standing there, and the security, we had, you know, code names for the travelers and all that. They came in, and everything went fine, other than they sent the wrong caterer, not the right guy. So I think I scared him, but he got over it. But anyway, everything went smooth. Matter of fact, the guest speaker had already left. Pamela Geller was still in the facility, and they announced on our radio that it looked like the event just ended. So I'm standing in my spot, and this little black car drives up. It's a two-door car, a Chevy Cobalt. Pulls up, goes past me, and past the driveway, and I had the opening on the far left-hand side of the driveway. Goes all the way to the other side of the driveway and stops partially in the driveway, but parallel to the roadway. So I'm looking kind of at the back corner of the car. Well, I can see the passenger side clearly. I can't see the driver's side as well, but it's, they're about 40, 35, 40 feet away. All of a sudden, I should have probably told you this already. I was not there alone. There was a security guard with the school district there, but he was unarmed. He was wearing a kind of a uniform, but he wasn't armed. So I was the only armed individual at this particular entrance. So while I'm standing there and I'm watching this, that hair on the back of your neck thing when it stands up, we've all experienced that. We just get this feeling something is not right here. It was the way they pulled up, the way they stopped. I noticed it had out-of-state tags on the car. These are all things that are going through my mind. The security guard, on the other hand, who testified later in a court hearing, said that he started to walk toward the car. I never saw him. He was behind me on my left. He started walking toward the car because he assumed it was somebody going to ask directions or something else. We were on a different wavelength. I wasn't thinking directions. I was thinking something didn't right with this car. This is not normal. This isn't the way people pull up and stop. So as I'm watching the car, both doors open simultaneously, and I can see the passenger side clearly, and I see the driver step out immediately and see the barrel of a rifle coming up. Well, I knew, based on my training, based on my experience, and I've been a policeman, I was just shy of my 37th anniversary with the department when this happened. I knew that my only choice in this matter, because I'm standing out in the middle of nowhere, I have no cover, no ability to get to cover, any of those kind of things. My only choice in this was to engage these guys, and I had the mental, I actually thought to myself, I need to be the aggressor in this encounter. If I'm not the aggressor, I don't really have much of a chance of survival. But I didn't have to make a plan. And the reason I didn't have to make a plan was based on my training. I had made that plan a long time ago. This is what I would do. Been to the range during police training, been to the range in my own time, and practiced multiple target assailants and all kinds of things. So when that happened, I didn't have to think of a plan. I reacted and did what I was trained to do, and that was to immediately engage those guys. And like I said, the only real conscious thought I had was, not only do I have to engage these guys, but I need to become the aggressor in this battle, or I really don't have much of a chance to survive. Well, understand this. I am not some super dead eye shot guy. I'm a good shooter. I shoot as much as I can. I practice. The more I practice, the better I shoot. Seems pretty sensible, doesn't it? If I don't practice, I don't shoot as good. That's the way that works. But I'm just a guy. I'm not some specially trained, special ops, super duper. I had some tactical training for SWAT. I was a negotiator on our SWAT team for nearly 22 years. I never worked as a tactical operator, although I had a little training in that. But I'm your everyday policeman that's out there day in, day out, protecting our communities. They're doing an outstanding job, may I add. Although the media might tell you otherwise. But in any case, so I immediately engaged the passenger, fired several rounds on him, and he went down and dropped his rifle, still within proximity of him, but he dropped his rifle. Then I immediately acquired the driver as he came around the back of the vehicle, already had his weapon up, and was firing, I believe, at the security guard. And I engaged him, fired several rounds on him, and he went down as well. Well, then I turned and I re-engaged the passenger because he was still a threat. He wasn't completely down and done. And the most concerning thing was he had his hands up near his chest, and they were moving around. Now, these guys were wearing body armor, and they were wearing, a tactical uniform-looking thing. They were wearing body armor and load-bearing vests. And a load-bearing vest has a bunch of, it's just a kind of, usually made of some kind of a web kind of material. It's got a bunch of pouches and pockets on it. And they had probably at least 10 extra 30-round mags for their, they were both carrying AK-47s. They had extra magazines in their load-bearing vests, and they were wearing body armor on top of that.